It was about 12 years ago that I first heard of this machine. It's a brain slicer, but not just any old brain slicer that you'd find at Home Depot or your local serial killer hobby shop. This is the best brain slicer in the world, and it lives at Harvard University. This machine may sound medieval, but it's at the heart of one of the grand scientific and computing challenges of our time. Researchers here want to use it to help them build a three-dimensional map of the human brain. They want to photograph a brain slice by slice, stitch all the pictures together into a computer model, and then go find every neuron and every synapse and the trillions of pathways that connect them. Scientists call this brain map the Connectome, and some of them are convinced it could unlock the secrets of how the mind works. Other people think this whole project is a colossal waste of money and time. Luckily for scientists and for you, I have come to Harvard to settle this matter once and for all. To the Connectome. Whenever I'm at Harvard, thinking about the origins of human consciousness and the mechanics of life, I visit this man.
I'm Jeff Lichtman. I'm a professor in the Molecular and Cellular Biology Department at Harvard University and a member of a group called the Center for Brain Science.
Jeff is also one of the world's leading connectome experts and runs a laboratory here.
This idea that there is a connectome, a wiring diagram that is worth knowing, it remains controversial to this day. To think about a map, a physical map of the brain's connections, very much the way people in genetics thought of the genome as a physical map of all the sequence information for every gene in a body. Genomics, at its early stages, there was also some controversy over whether it was really a good idea or not. It was also considered a huge data set. It was about 1.4 gigabytes
Amazing.
Of data. 1.4 gigabytes, and people were thinking, what are we going to do with so much data? But the idea here is that the technologies now exist to get wiring diagrams down to the level of every single connection of every single nerve cell to every other nerve cell.
You're basically talking about finding every neuron, every synapse, all these connections between them. And so, I mean, we're talking about on the order of trillions of wires.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it's almost inconceivable. To get a wiring diagram of the brain, you need enough resolution to see every single synapse. And that resolution is lower than the resolution of light microscopes.
It's controversial. What's the great pro case for why we want to do this? You see that the United States has put tons of money in trying to do a connectome. Europe has put tons of money. So obviously there's a group of people that believe this is a big deal. Why? What is the big hope?
Maybe the one that is most generally interesting is that there are a number of disorders of brains where we still have a very poor idea of what actually is wrong. And a number of people believe that the reason these diseases are so difficult is that they go to the structure of the brain. And we have really no idea what those pathologies are. Diseases that are not uncommon: autism, spectrum disorder, schizophrenia, Tourette's syndrome. I don't think we're gonna get very far until we have some physical evidence of what's wrong. Memory in its true sense, in the sense of a neuroscience thinking about it, or the way a normal person thinks about what they remember, where is that? What is that? What does it look like? How is it configured in the brain? It's almost certainly in the wiring diagram, but until we start getting wiring diagrams, we're not going to have a good idea of what they are.
A brain schematic sounds like an easy enough thing to build. But in the decade plus that I've been following connectome projects around the globe, progress has proven tough to come by. Researchers have managed to build models of tiny worm brains and slightly larger fly brains. The goal these days is to image an entire mouse brain, and then one day, far in the future, a human brain. It turns out that our brains are so complex that they require an almost unprecedented amount of computing to analyze.
You guys recently did a cerebral cortex in a human.
But a cubic millimeter.
A cubic millimeter of that. But that's how hard this is, right? How long is it? How long have you?
That took several years.
Several years.
And two teams, a big team at Google and a big team in my lab.
Okay.
Working full time
on
this. The problem here is that the wires are not ordered. They're not all running like train tracks in the same direction. They're running in three-dimensional space, more the way spaghetti in a bowl would run. One way of generating a map of every wire in every direction is to cut that bowl of spaghetti, piece of brain, into very thin slices, take each of those pictures, then align them, and then find a piece of spaghetti and track it through the volume, and then start with another piece of spaghetti and track it through the volume, and keep doing that until you have all the spaghetti. These are 30 nanometer sections typically, which is about a thousandth the thickness of a human hair.
Okay.
Each section.
The first step in building a connectome is to get your hands on some brains and then cut them up. It all sounds very grim, but Harvard turns out to be quite efficient with its brain harvesting. Jeff's lab can do a year's worth of research with a single mouse brain. Small chunks of the brain are fed into the slicer, where a diamond blade carves off a thin sliver of tissue. The tissue floats along some liquid and onto a piece of tape. The brain slices are then put into this very large machine, where they're photographed in the finest of detail. Software helps stitch the pictures back together into a single 3D image, and algorithms are applied to help make sense of what's going on inside of the brain. This summer, Lichtman's lab, along with Google, announced their major breakthrough on the human connectome front. They created a 1.4 petabyte visual model from 1 cubic millimeter of human cortex. Within that tiny sample were millions of neurons and 130 million synapses. All of these parts were then labeled by an obedient and hardworking AI algorithm.
Whose brain sample is it? Was there something?
It's a woman who had had epilepsy.
And she had surgery or something?
She had surgery and to remove the epileptic focus. The neurosurgeons made an incision in the temporal lobe to get access to the disease site so they could extirpate or in some way remove the part of the brain that was causing the epilepsy. If we zoom up, every one of these objects is now a uniquely identified object in the data. There's hundreds of millions of objects in here. If I take an object like this that has a sort of triangular shape that looks like a pyramidal neuron and I just double click on it, there it is.
I mean, it almost looks like a cartoon, but that's the actual...
This is a real cell. And if I do that for this cell, there is it. And if I do it for this cell, I'm gonna have to unzoom a little bit to give you a sense of this, but...
You're making the bowl of spaghetti.
And everything in there is traceable. That's a place where a cell receives a synapse. And then I'm gonna zoom up on that spot in the electron micrograph. Here is an axon making a synapse on that dendritic spine. Yeah. And I can do that for every one of these. Let's look at this. So this is something I saw with my own eyes and then asked my colleagues if they'd ever seen anything like this, and no one had. So here is an axon. That's something that's talking, where the dendrites of the cell are in red, that's the cell that's listening. And this axon comes to this position on the cell and makes something that looks sort of like a turban. It's a massive wiring weirdness. But if you follow this axon, it keeps doing this. Here's the same axon, another whirl. And that's the thing about large data. These things that are called unicorns, you know, these weird things that there's one of, when you have 1.4 petabytes of data, you can discover that they're rare, but they're not one-offs.
Do we have any speculation about why this happens?
One person in my lab, Richard Schleck, suggested that maybe this is a magnetic coil, that the electricity travels here and it generates a magnetic charge. I think that's a crazy idea, but he took offense. He said, you got a better idea?
Not everyone at Harvard is a full-on Connectome believer. So, for another view on the matter, may I please present to you the bad boy of brain science, Florian Engert. This man knows how to make an entrance.
Ashley!
Hello!
Good to see you.
How are you?
I'm well.
Good.
Lovely day.
It is a nice day, huh? Is that how you usually cruise around?
That's how I commute.
Sitting here, slotted between two rhinos, I got right into it and asked this man in a purple muscle tee what he makes of brain maps.
There's controversies around the Connectome to some degree of some people. There's people who think it will be useful in different ways, so there's some debates there. Then there's a camp of people who think this is maybe not a waste of time, but it's not going to lead. Yeah, so where do you fall? Is the Connectome a worthwhile pursuit?
Well, it's not going to be sufficient. Maybe that's the most important statement. Just having the Connectome by itself will tell you basically nothing. I think it is extremely useful once you have a model, a theory of how it works, the brain, and you want to use the Connectome to falsify or test or constrain your model.
Florian's lab specializes in researching the brains of zebrafish. And he has a glorious collection of tens of thousands of them. These fish turn out to be ideal for brain research. Just after they're born, they have translucent skin. This means that scientists can peer directly into the animals' minds and watch their neurons fire. Florian and his team of overeducated fish farmers have altered the genes of these animals so that their neuronal activity really lights up under a microscope.
We have maybe a few thousand different transgenic fish lines, the different populations of fish that we need to monitor and manipulate neural activity in individual parts of the brain. And that's what you see here.
And so like each case would maybe have a different property or?
You need more than one row. So from here to here, they would all have express a fluorescent indicator in a very specific part of the brain. And other fish would express in different areas of the brain or a different indicator.
Who keeps track of what happens? I mean, you just have them all numbered and somebody's...
Oh yeah, no. We have a barcoding system.
Yeah.
There's a whole database that needs to get updated. And we have a staff of three people and a head fish mistress who takes care of the whole facility. And she keeps track of maintenance and housekeeping.
Well, when you're looking at this brain activity, it's the first couple days of their life.
It's day 5 till day 8.
Okay.
Day 5 or day 6 old zebrafish has a whole repertoire of behaviors that they need to survive. That's what they do. They interact with conspecifics, they hunt, they escape from predators, and they navigate.
Florian was too important to explain how the actual microscoping part of all this works. And so poor postdoc Gregor stepped in to help.
So I can get a fish in a dish and then carry it into the microscope and then kind of set up an experiment.
First, Gregor embeds the fish in the laboratory equivalent of Jell-O. Then he strips away bits of the Jell-O to let the zebra fish move its body and tail. The idea is to see how the brain works in a living animal going about its day-to-day activities.
And so you can see that when I tap the dish, then it'll do this little tail flick.
To see the neurons, you would use a different microscope,
that's
a more high-powered machine.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So you do this and then you take it and then just image deeper.
Exactly.
Okay.
The scientists often use light patterns to trick the fish into thinking that they're swimming in a stream or running into an obstacle. It's like fish VR.
Because the dots are changing which way they go, so the fish is going to be kind of changing its pattern.
Yeah, exactly. Fish is going to swim left, right. This is brain activity that you see, all these purple and orange dots, these are individual cell bodies. And whenever they flash, that means these cells become active.
In a way, Florian's fish study is the opposite of the connectome approach. Rather than trying to untangle the whole bowl of spaghetti, his lab can zero in on the specific spots in the brain that light up in response to stimuli, and then start to develop a theory of what fishy thoughts look like.
Can you give me an example on those lines? Like a zebrafish does X, and I could see that in the brain and find out whether that's right or wrong.
So for example, one of the things we are studying is working memory. So the fish sees a pulse of motion, yes, sir, and it remembers that for a few seconds, yes, sir. And now we've identified a brain region where this information, this activity, is being stored in a recurrent circuit. So we can see by imaging, by recording activity, that there's information in this ventral hindbrain circuit of the fish where this information stays. So we sort of have found now a nucleus for working memory,
okay, right?
where this information is being stored transiently. I think the critical part is you need to know already, right, how it works, and then you can use it to test. Many of my friends and colleagues, and they won't like what I say now, right? So if you don't know how it works, then having the connectome is going to hurt you more than it's going to help. It's going to be much more confusing than illuminating.
Should we be spending money to even try to do a human connectome, or is it just even if just because we can, or is
I think we should, absolutely. It's about expectation management. We should not do the human connectome the same we shouldn't have done the genome for the purpose of using it to directly cure disease or help the human condition, because that's not going to work. So. But what it's useful for is to help the existing science infrastructure to constrain the models, right? It's another additional tool that will help you with incremental insight.
Most of the wealthiest people in the world these days are tech people, and they're interested in stuff. It seemed like, well, we could do this, and we could do it a lot faster if we just had 50 high-powered microscopes and more brain slicers. Yeah. I'm surprised no really wealthy person. It's interesting where the brain stacks up versus the body on some of the priorities of research.
It's not clear what you would do with it. I think maybe that's the problem. If you had a billionaire and say, I can give you a connectome, I mean, her question would be, what am I going to do with that, right? What will you do once you have the connectome? And I think one of the most prevalent applications, which I think is batshit crazy, is to upload. Yes, sir.
To animate your mind.
Once you have a connectome,
or...
that is the substrate of your mind, right, that you can then actually upload it into a computer and emulate your mind. There's a lot of also rich people who are after that. Yeah. And I think an uploading of my brain is more like making a backup copy, right, that is disjointed from my own identity. Yeah. There's really a philosophical flaw, a wrong way of thinking, that a copy is the same as a continuation of my own life. Yes. So that's why I think all of this is complete nonsense. I mean, this idea of the connectome as a tool to upload my mind into a computer and achieve immortality is crazy.
After spending a couple of days talking about brains, I took a slow walk around Harvard to feel what Ivy League life is like. As I sauntered majestically, I thought about Mark Zuckerberg building a dating site here, and then ending up as our digital emperor. I thought about how weird it is that we're totally dependent on Google's huge computers and algorithms to do so much cutting-edge research. And I thought about my director, David, running with a rollerblading brain scientist. I thought about a lot of things, and well, I reckon it would be nice if we knew how that happens.